Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum.
Thank you very much for coming. Insyaallah. Thank you very much for the host, Sidi Ben Alawi, and of course to our honored guest, the Shaykh Mohammed Aslam from Birmingham, UK. He has been here since Friday, and been giving a 2-day lecture at IKIM in Kuala, Lumpur, and tonight will be the closing lecture for this time around, inshallah. We dua that he will come again, inshallah, in the future. And may Allah grant him with good health and for us to benefit from him, inshallah, tonight and every time in the future, sometime in the future, inshallah. So I think without further ado, I would like to invite Brother Muhammad to start reading from the first paragraph of the Bushra of Sayyidah Khadijah Al Kubra, inshallah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي شرف هذا الوجود ببعثة أكرم النبي وأعز المولود سيدنا ومولانا محمد النبي المقدس المحمود ذي الشفاعة العظمى والحوض المورود عنصر الفضائل المشهود وكريم الأمهات والآباء والجلود نخبة العالم وسيد ولد آدم من انتقل في الغرار والكلمة نوره وأضاء الكون ميلاده وبعثته وظهوره وطلع الشمس الهداية والعرفان بانفلاق وصبحه على كل الأكوان وصلاة والسلام على سيد السادات كامل الشمائل والصفات ذي النور العليم والقدر العظيم وصراط المستقيم والدين القويم والحسن الصميم والمجد الفحيم وعلى آله وصحابته وأزواجه وذريته والتابعين من أهل ملته وخديجة التي تشرفت بعشرته وصحبته وفازت بقزمته وشهدت يوم بعثته وقامت بتأييده في دعوته ومؤازرته ونصرته أما بعد فهذه النفاحة النبوية وفي وضعات ربانية جرى بها القلم في مناقب أم المؤمنين وفضائل زوجة سيد المرسلين وشمائلها التي هي من أحسن الشمائل المقتبسة من أخلاق ذلك الإنسان الكامل سيد الأواخر والأوائل جمعتها لك تتعطر بها المجالس والنوادم في الحواضر والبواديم انتخبتها من عيون الأخبار ومجامع الآثار الموادعة في السيار والأسفار وضمنتها من ذلك كل ما هو مقبول عند الأئمة والحفاظ والفحول من كل قول محمود ليس بموضوع ولا مردود وهذا أوام الشروع في المقصود بعون الملك المعبود فأقول يا سيدتنا خديجة بنت خويلد بن أسد بن عبد العزى بن قصي الأسدية تجتمع مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في جده قصي الذي جمع القبائل القريشية وأمها فاطمة بنت زائدة بن العصم من بني عامر بن لؤي بن غالب فأكرم بهذا النصب الطاهر الذي هو نصب أشرف الحبائب وقد حفظه الله تعالى من أرجاس الجاهلية فأحاط عرض هذه السيدة الذكية وصانه من كل أزية وبلية برعايته وعنايته الباهرة ولذلك كانت تلقب بالسيدة الطاهرة فما أجل هذه المنحة الفاخرة واشتهر تلقيبها بالكبرى لعزم شأنها في المعاهد الأخرى وهي بذلك أحق وأحرى وقد ولدت رضي الله عنها قبل ولادته صلى الله عليه وسلم وآله بنحو 15 سنة فنشأت في البيت طاهر طيب الأعراق وعلى أكمل السير المحمودة وأحسن الأخلاق وكانت رضي الله عنها متكاملة حسنا وعقلا وجمالا وفضلا حازمة رشيدة في جميع أمورها، حسنة التدبير والتصرف في جميع شؤونها، ذات فراسة قوية وهمة عالية، لها نظر ثاقب ومعرفة دقيقة بالعواقب. أغناه الله تعالى بسعة النعم وكثيرة الخدم والحشم، ومنى عليها في الجلال وبكثرة الأموال، فكانت تستأجر الرجال ليتاجروا في ذلك بالحلال، وتضاربهم عليه بشيء معلوم، ويستفيد بذلك الجميع على العموم. وظهرت أسرار تلك الأخلاق المرضية والأوصاف الحسنة الزكية فيما بلغته بين قومها في الجاهلية، من مكانة عالية ورتبة ثانية وشهرة قوية، فهي درة الثامنة الطاهرة الرازنة، لوحة المجد الطيبة الفروق، وشجرة الفرد يعتو الأفرار والمجموع. اللهم انشر نفاحة الرضوان عليها، وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها، وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
وقد أراد الله تعالى لهذه السيدة الطاهرة أن تجمع بين شرف الدنيا وعز الآخرة، فوصلت إليها أخبار سيد المرسلين، وأخذت التعرف عليها بتدبر وتفكر ويقين، فرأت أنه المجمع على فضله المبين، وأنه المشهود له بأنه التقي النقي الأمين، وأنه الصادق المصدق مصدق، والكريم الذي لا يلحق ولا يسبق. فعلمت أن معاملة مثل هذا ناجحة، ومتاجرته إن شاء الله رابحة، فما كان منها إلا أن بعثت إليه وعرضت مشروعها التجاري عليه، وهو أن يتجر لها في مالها، وتعطيه أفضل ما تعطيه لأمتها. فقبل ذلك عليه الصلاة والسلام، وخرج بتجارتها من البلد الحرام قاصدا بلاد الشام، وهذه هي الرحلة الثانية. ولم يثبت أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم سافر إلى الشام إلا في هاتين المرتين في عامين مختلفين، كما ذكره بعض الحفاظ المرجوع إليهم المعول على قولهم. وأرسلت معه ميسرة الغلام، وأوصته عليه، وأمرته أن يكون قائما بخدمته حق القيام، فألقى الله محبة النبي في قلبه حتى أخذت بعقله ولبه، وخدمها فأخلص خدمته، وصحبه فأحسن صحبته، ورأى بعينه شيئا من أسراره، وسمع بأذنه ما سمع من أخباره، ومن ذلك ما حدثهم به الراهب نسورا، وهو حق ليس بخرافة ولا أسطورة، إذ قال ذلك الراهب: وقد رأي أشرف الحبائب نزل تحت شجرة هناك، من هذا الذي يفوق بدر الأفلاك؟ فقال ميسرة: هذا رجل من الكرام من أهل البلد الحرام. فقال له الراهب وهو واثق مما يقول: ما نزل تحت هذه الشجرة إلا نبي أو رسول. ثم قال لميسرة: أفي عينيه همرة لا تفارقه. قال نعم. قال هذا آخر نبي فهنيئا لمن يصدقه. ثم في تلك الأثناء وقع بين سيد الأنبياء ورجل كان في تلك الأنحاء خلاف في بعض المشتريات، فقال له الرجل اثلف بالعز واللات كما يجري بينهم في مثل تلك الحالات. فقال سيد السادات والله ما حلفت بهما وإني لأمر فأعرض عنهما. فقال الرجل القول قولك والرأي عندك. ثم قال لميسرة هذا والله نبي تشرفنا به في سوقنا، وإنه لتجده أحبارنا منعوتا في كتبنا. ومن ذلك أنه كان يرى في تلك المدة القصيرة سحابة تظلله دون الجميع في وقت ظهيرة. وقيل فيما روي أنه كان يرى ملكين يظللان سيد القونين
صلى الله عليه وسلم.
ولما أتم صلى الله عليه وسلم مهمته وباع سلعته رجع إلى مكة وقد اكتسب خيرات كثيرة وجاء بأرباح وفيرة. فصرت بذلك سيدة خديجة أيما سرور وحمدت في فعله المشكور ونظرت إليه بعين الإكبار والإحترام.
الله.
وأكرمته غاية الإكرام وأثرت شخصيته فيها كل تأثير، فأكنت له في نفسها عظيم التقدير. وزاد ذلك عندها بعدما حدثها ميسرة بما شاهده من الآيات وعجائب الأحوال وفوارق العادات التي هي للنبوة دلائل وواضحات. حدثها عن السهابة التي صحبته في سفره فكانت نعم الصاحب، وعن طاعة الإبيل وطي الأرض له، والتوفيق الذي لازمه في سفره كل الملازمة، وتلك الرمال والحجارة التي لانت تحت مواطئ قدميه، وكل ذلك وعاه بقلبه
ورآه بعينيه
وحدثها بما رآه من حسن سيرته في خلقه ومعاملته مع ما سبق لها معرفته عنه من صدق حديثه وعظيم أمانته وكريم أخلاقه وديانته. فأصبحت هذه الصفات والأخلاق العلية مثبتة متيقنة لديها جلية، فأحست بعارض غريب عن صورة وحقيقة ذلك الحبيب، وتحيرت من أمر نفسها، وأصبحت قلقة بين قلبها وعواطفها، فقد رفضت بالأمس القريب الكثير من الرجال من ذوي الوجاهة والمال، وردتهم خائبين متحسرين لرفضها طلبهم المطين. اللهم انشر نفحات الإخوان عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها، وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
بسم الله بعدك. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه. ولما أراد الله تعالى لها السعادة الأبدية والشرف والفضل على نساء البرية ترجح عندها أن لا تفوت هذه الفرصة الذهبية. واستنابت خديجة أنه الكنز الذي حاولته الكيمياء فاختارت لنفسها النبي الأمين سيد ولد آدم أجمعين. ومن لاحت في وجهه علامة الجبن والجمال وتكاملت فيه خصال الكمال والجلال وبدت عليه أمارة السيادة وظهرت منه إشارة النجابة والقيادة فما كان منها إلا أن أرسلت إليه وعرضت نفسها عليه فخطبت الرسول العظيم والنبي الأكرم صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال له يا ابن عم يا ابن العم إني قد رغبت فيك لقرابتك وشرفك وسامي منزلتك وقدرك. وفي رواية أنها أرسلت له نفيسة بنت أمية دسيسا إليه فقالت له ما يمنعك أن تتزوج؟ فقال ما في يدي شيء. فقالت له فإن كفيت ودعيت إلى المال والجمال والكفاءة قال ومن؟ قالت له خديجة فأجاب. ورأته خديجة والتقى والزهد فيه سجية والحياء وأتاها أن الغمامة والسرح وأظلته منهما أفياء. وأحاديث أن وعد رسول الله بالبعث حان منه الوفاء فدعته إلى الزواج وما أحسن يبلغ المنى الأذكياء. وقد ألهم الله نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم الموافقة فكانت خطوة مباركة موافقة فشاور عمامه الكرام وأيدوه على ذلك الكلام. فتقدم حمزة فكلم عمها وقيل أباها والصحيح أن أباها خويلد قد مات قبل حرب الفجار. ثم حضر رؤساء قريش يتقدمهم أبو طالب فكان هو لسان حالهم المتكلم الخاطب فقال الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من ذرية إبراهيم وزرع إسماعيل وضئضئ معد وعنصر مضر وجعلنا حضرة بيته وسواس حرمه وجعلنا بيتا محجوبا وحرما آمنا وجعلنا الحكام على الناس. ثم إن أبن أخي هذا محمد بن عبد الله لا يوزن به رجل إلا رجح به فإن كان في المال قل فإن المال ذل زائل وأمر حائل ومحمد من قد عرفتم قرابته وقد خطب خديجة بنت خويلد وبذل لها من الصداق ما آجله وعاجله من مالي كذا وهو والله بعد هذا نبأ عظيم وخطب جليل. ثم قام ورقة بن نوفل فقال الحمد لله الذي جعلنا كما ذكرت وفضلنا على ما عددت فنحن سادة العرب وقادتها وأنتم أهل ذلك كله لا تنكر العشيرة فضلكم ولا يرد أحد من الناس فخركم وشرفكم وقد رضينا في الاتصال بحبلكم فاشهدوا علي معشر قريش بأني قد تزوجت خديجة بنت خويلد من محمد بن عبد الله على 400 دينار. ثم سكت فقال أبو طالب قد أجبت أن يشركك عمها. فقال عمها اشهدوا يا معشر قريش أني قد أنكحت محمد بن عبد الله خديجة بنت خويلد وشهد على ذلك صناديق قريش. اللهم انشرنا محاذي الرضوان عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
وقد جاء في سيرة ابن هشام أنه عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام أصدقها 20 بكرة سنية وقيل 12 أوقية من ذهب ونصف أوقية وكل هذا لا يعارض ما جاء في خطبة ورقة ابن نوفل السابقة من أن الصداق 400 درهم إذ يمكن الجمع بينهما بتقويم الثمن بذلك أو أن أحد الأشياء مهر والآخر هدية من عمه أبي طالب للسيدة خديجة أو أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم زاد ذلك في صداقها على صداق عمه فكان الكل صداقا اللهم انشر نفحات الرضوان عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وتزوج نبينا الأمين سيدتنا أم المؤمنين وقد أتم 25 وأتممت هي 40 قال صاحب قرة الأبصار وإذ إلى مكة عاد وافتتح 26 من العمر نكح خديجة من بعد 40 مضت لها من عمرها سنينا وقد نحر صلى الله عليه وسلم جزورا أو جزورين وقرت بذلك من المحبين العين وانشرحت منهم الصدور وعم الفرح والسرور وطلع سعد السعود وانكمد الفؤاد المفود وغدا الحسود لا يسود وهو موهوم وقال أبو طالب الحمد لله الذي أذهب عنا الكرب والمغوم وقال في ذلك الراجز في قوله المنظوم لا تزهدي خديج في محمد نجم يضيء كإضاء الفرقد اللهم انشر نفحات الرضوان عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصلي وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ولما تزوجت خديجة سيد ولد عدنان كان قد تزوجها قبله رجلان وهما هند أبو هالة بن زرارة من بني عدي وعتيق بن عائد بن مخزوم القرشي وقد اختلفوا في تعيين الثاني من الأول وليس في ذلك نص صريح عليه يعول وقد كان عندها من الذرية من غير خير البرية عبد مناف وهند وهما من زوجها عتيق وقيل إن هندا هذه أسلمت وفازت بالصحبة والتصديق وولدت لأبي هالة ولدا وسموه هندا وهو صحابي جليل ممن شهد بدرا وأحدا وقد روى حديثا مشهورا في صفات النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقتل يوم الجمل مع سيدنا علي ذو الوجه المكرم وذكر بعضهم أنه مات بالبصرة في الطاعون وكان قد مات في ذلك اليوم 70,000 مسلمون فشغل الناس بجنائزهم وتركت جنازته ولم يوجد من يحملها فصاحت نادبته واهنداه ابن هنداه وربيب رسول الله فلم تبق جنازة إلا وتركت وأما جنازته فحملت وازدحم الناس فامتلأت بهم المواضع وما حملت إلا على أطراف الأصابع وقال بعضهم إن الذي مات في الطاعون ابن هذا المذكور ويسمى بهند أيضا والخلاف في ذلك مشهور وكان فصيحا بليغا وصافا محسنا وصف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فكان مجيدا متقنا وكان يقول أنا أكرم الناس أبا وأما وأخا وأختا أبي رسول الله وأمي خديجة التي عنها رضي الله وأخي القاسم عليه السلام وأختي فاطمة عليها الرحمة والإكرام ولخديجة من أبيها لتبنان غير هذا المذكور الطاهر والآخر هالة والأول غير مشهور اللهم انشر نفحات الرضوان عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وقد كان لها رضي الله عنها مواقف مع زوجها مشكورة فلا تذكر قصة الوحي والبعثة إلا وهي معها مذكورة وسنذكر مسألة الوحي من أولها لنعرف مقدار هذه السيدة وفضلها فاعلم أن أول ما بدي به رسول الله من النبوة التي تفضل بها عليه مولاه أنه كان لا يمر بشجرة ولا حجرة إلا قال السلام عليك يا رسول الله وغير ذلك من الإرهاصات التي أشهرها الرؤيا الصادقة فكان صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يرى رؤية في نومه إلا وكانت لا محالة واقعة وحبب الله إليه الخلوة ولم يكن شيء أحب إليه من أن يخلو وحده فكان يجاور من كل سنة شهرا في حراء مشتغلا بالعبادة والتفكر في ملكوت الأرض والسماء وكان إذا خرج إلى حراء تتكفل خديجة بكل حاجاته وتحقق له كافة رغباته وتهيئ له الطعام والشراب وتيسر له ما تستطيع من الأسباب فينقطع لمقصوده ويقبل على معبوده وهو مرتاح البال من كل متعلقات والأشغال فإذا طالت غيبته عليها تركت كل ما لديها وخرجت تتلمسه في مكانه الذي تعود الذهاب إليه وقلبها يخفق من شدة خوفها عليه حتى إذا رأته مستغرقا في وحدته منجمعا على فكرته رجعت ولم تكلمه لئلا تقطعه عن خلوته وتبقى منتظرة موعد عودته لتعمل جاهدة على إزالة وحشته وإدخال السرور إلى قلبه والسعادة إلى نفسه اللهم انشر نفحات الرضوان عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ولقد كانت خديجة صادقة الفراسة صائبة النظرة صافية الفكرة وكانت على ثقة من أن رجلا كزوجها محمد الأمين يحمل هذه الروح العلية والنفس السامية والفضائل التي ما عرفتها قريش بأسرها يضاف إلى ما نقله إليها عبدها ومما سبق ذكره وتقدم نشره كانت على ثقة من أنه سيكون له شأن عظيم يتحدث عنه المسافر والمقيم وسيحدث في التاريخ أمرا تهتز له الدنيا عجبا وتيها وفخرا فما أجل عينها الصادقة الحنون وما أعظم قلبها العطوف الذي يزوده بالرعاية ويخفق له فرحا منتظرا يومه الذي تنصب له فيه الراية وينشر له مرسوم الولاية ومرت الأيام على هذا النظام فما أكمل الأربعين على التمام حتى جاء اليوم الذي هيأته القدرة الربانية لإبلاغه الرسالة السماوية وهو في وحدته التعبدية بعد أن مهدت من قبل الأسباب وتفتحت لذلك الأبواب فأتاه في ذلك المقام في اليقظة لا في المنام رسول الملك العلام وقال له اقرأ فقال ما أنا بقارئ ولست من جملة القراء فأخذه فغطه وما تركه حتى بلغ غاية الجهد والإعياء ثم أمره بالقراءة مرة ثانية فامتنع فأخذه وغطه وما تركه إلا بعدما كاد يقع وفي الثالثة قال له اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم فما أعظمها من إشارة أوصلتها يد الإحسان من حضرة الامتنان إلى هذا الإنسان وأيدتها بشارة الرحمن الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان ولا شك أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم هو المقصود بهذا التعليم من حضرة الرحمن الرحيم فرجع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى زوجته بعد أن شهد مشهد كرامته وفؤاده يرجف من هول ما رآه وشدة ما سمعه وقرأ ولقد كاد ينخلع لولا تثبيت مولاه وقال زملوني زملوني فزملته فلما ذهب عنه الروع وحدثها قال لها لقد خشيت على نفسي فداه أبي وأمي ونفسي فقالت كلا والله لا يخزيك الله أبدا وإن الله سيكتب لك عزا ومجدا وسؤددا فرحمك موصولة فرحمك موصولة ويدك لضيفك مبذولة تحمل الكل وتكسب المعدوم وتقري الضيف وتعين على نوائب الحق كل مكلوم واثبت يا ابن العم فلك البشرى فوالله لقد كنت أعلم أن الله لا يفعل بك إلا خيرا وإني أشهد أنك نبي هذه الأمة المنتظر وهذا زمانك إن شاء الله قد حضر وقد أخبرني ناصح غلامي وبحير الراحب بخبرك المبين وأمرني أن أتزوجك قبل 20 من السنين اللهم انشر نفحات الرضوان عليها وأمدها بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم انطلقت به إلى ورقة بن نوفل وأخبرته بالتفصيل فقال لسيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم حدثيني بفمك أيها السيد النبيل حدثني بفمك أيها السيد النبيل فأخذ يحدثه بما رآه وسمعه من سيدنا جبريل فقال ورقة هذا والله الناموس الجليل الذي كان ينزل على موسى رسول بني إسرائيل يا ليتني أكون حاضرا ومؤيدا لدعوتك وناصرا وفي رواية أن السيدة خديجة قالت لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في أول أمره إذا جاء صاحبك بالوحي فأخبرني بخبره فلما جاءه أخبرها فقالت اجلس على شقي الأيمن فجلس فقالت أتراه الآن؟ قال نعم قالت فتحول فاجلس في حجري فتحول فجلس في حجرها فقالت هل تراه الآن؟ قال نعم فرفعت خمارها عن رأسها وقالت هل تراه الآن؟ قال لا ف فقالت ما هذا بشيطان هذا ملك من ملائكة الرحمن اللهم انشر عليها وأمدنا بالأسرار التي أودعتها لديها وصل وسلم على زوجها الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
So you speak now?
Yeah.
How long do you have?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا محمد حبيب رب العالمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين وعلى أزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ثم أما بعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we thank Him for gathering us in a gathering of remembrance which is attended by the angels of the heavens, and we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon our Master Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon His blessed family and companions, and in particular upon His blessed wives, our mothers, and in particular from amongst them, the greatest of them, Sayyidatuna Khadijah Al Kubra radiyallahu anha, and upon her children, and in particular upon Sayyidatuna Fatimah Al Zahra ridwanullahi alayha, and in particular upon her children, Sayyiduna Al Hasan Wal Hussein, and upon their children up until the day of standing. Ameen, ameen, ameen. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al Ahzab, He speaks about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam and his blessed relationship unto his ummah, and he speaks about the blessed wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that same portion of the verse, and he says, "An-nabiyyu awla bil-mu'minina min anfusihim wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam is more closer to the believing people than themselves, and he gives greater priority to the believing people than that which they can give their own selves. وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ, and his wives are their mothers. And his wives are their mothers. And this indicates a great relationship that each and every one of us has been granted unto the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And from amongst them was our mother, Sayyidatuna Khadijah al-Kubra radiyallahu anha, who in Makkah al-Mukarramah was known as At-Tahira, the pure woman. And she was a leader woman who was a businesswoman, and she was very affluent and very rich in Makkah al-Mukarramah. And before she married the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, she was married twice. She was married to Abu Hala and she was married to Atiq. And it was disputed as to which order she was married in, but regardless, she was married twice before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And from both of her husbands previously, she had children. And then she was offered by many people in Makkah al-Mukarramah for marriage, but she refused all of them because she was looking for qualities and she was looking for attributes that were much beyond that of wealth and materialism. Because people saw that she was a rich, affluent woman and she came from one of the most centralized families of Quraysh. She came from a very noble and honorable tribe, from the tribe of Quraysh. But Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha was searching out for something else. She was looking for some qualities that would give her coolness in her eyes and comfort in her heart. So then Abu Talib came to her and said, "Khadijah, I have an employee that I want you to take on. But the condition is that you pay him double that which you pay anybody else." So she said, "Who is it?" And he said, "It's Muhammad, my nephew, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Sayyidah Khadijah said, "Had you asked me to pay an enemy of yours double that which I pay anybody else, I would have done so. How is it that you ask me to pay the most beloved of the Meccan people double what you want? I will indeed give him." And then he came back to the Prophet and said, "Rizqun saqahu Allahu ilayk." Allah has brought provision to you. Allah has sent rizq to you. You will work for Sayyidah Khadijah. And he went and he did business for her. And she sent him on a business trip to Asham. And this was the second of the trips that he made unto Asham.
and there wasn't a third of them. And he went with Maysara, and she informed Maysara that I want you to watch him carefully and watch every move that he makes extremely carefully. So Maysara went with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They got to Asham, and there they saw a Christian priest who saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam resting under a tree. So he came to Maysara and he said, "Who is this?" He said, "Rajulun min ahli al-haram." He's a man from the people of the Haram, i.e. from Makkah al-Mukarramah. And the Christian priest said, "Never has a man lay under this tree except that he was a prophet." And then Maysara looked into the eyes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he saw a redness in his eyes. The Christian priest saw a redness in the eyes of the Prophet. So he asked Maysara, "This redness, is it always there or has it just arrived?" And Maysara said, "No, he always has a redness in his eyes." And then the Christian priest saw that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking in the heat, that the clouds from the heavens would descend over his head and give him shade. When he saw all of these signs, he informed Maysara that this is the last and final prophet of this ummah, and he will have a great matter to come before him. And then they returned. The Prophet done his business, and he bought and he sold, and then he returned to Makkah al-Mukarramah. And when he reported back to Khadijah radiallahu anha, he reported back with that much wealth and that much profit that no other business person and no other employee of Khadijah had ever bought back before. This was through the blessings and through the barakah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then she interviewed Maysara and said, "So what was it and how was he in this trip?" So Maysara said, "He was exactly with the character that he is in Makkah. There was no difference. Because when somebody travels, the real colors prevail. The true colors of a person prevail and come out in travel." And then he informed, Maysara informed Khadija radiallahu anha of what the Christian priest had said. And this increased the confidence of Sayyida Khadija in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then there are various narrations. One narration said that Sayyida Khadija herself approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "I see you to be from a very noble family, and I see that you have beautiful character and good traits and attributes, and I want to offer myself in marriage to you." But the other narration is that Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha had a friend whose name was Nufaysa, and she said to her, "Go and speak to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about marriage." So Nufaysa came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ala tatazawwaj? Why don't you get married? You're a young, handsome man." And the Prophet said, "I don't have anything to marry with." And she said, "How about if who is offering and who is asking doesn't want anything from you, but she has honor, she has dignity, and she has wealth?" And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Who is this woman that you are speaking about?" And Nufaysa said, "It's Khadija." And it struck the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that what a match this is. So the Prophet said, "How is it that you can continue with this then?" And Nufaysa said, "If you agree, I will crack the rest." So Nufaysa went back and spoke to Khadija and informed her of what the Prophet said. Khadija went back to her uncle because her father had passed away. And the Prophet went back to his uncle, Sayyidina Hamza and Abu Talib, and informed them and spoke to them. Then the families agreed and they came together and the marriage was conducted. And Abu Talib, he stood up and he delivered a khutbah and he said, "Praise be to the one who made us from the children of Ibrahim and from the progeny of Ismail, and he made us from the hosts of the people who come for Hajj and those who look after the haram of Makkah." And he praised his family and his tribe, and then he said, "This nephew of mine, even though he doesn't have much material and much wealth in his hands, for material and wealth is a shadow that will come and go, but rather he has character and he has good qualities that if they are weighed with any man in Makkah, they will outweigh all of the men of Makkah." And then Abu Talib agreed with the family on a dowry and he gave it out on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the nikah was complete. And then Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha moved in with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. And what a marriage it was. What comfort she found and what comfort he found in her nobody can describe except the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who would say, even after she had passed away, he would say, Allah has never given me anybody better than Khadija. She believed in me when people disbelieved in me. She gave me when people prevented me. And she looked after me and gave me comfort and love when the world turned their backs on me. And Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha was an extremely understanding woman of the qualities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to such an extent that one day the Prophet said to her, Khadija, why is it that you treat me so well and treat me in this such a beautiful way? And Khadija said, I once heard that the time of the final and last Prophet is very close and imminent, and I have a conviction and belief in my heart that you will be that Prophet. This is why I am treating you like this. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say to her, indeed I am that Prophet. He said, if I am that Prophet, then you have struck the correct place. And if I am not, then Allah will reward you for serving a Prophet. And where did this story come from? Sayyidah Khadija said, one day I was sitting with my friends, long before she married the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. While she was a young lady, she said, I was sitting around with my friends, some other women, and a Jewish man passed by us, and he said to us, young ladies, the last and final Prophet is to come very soon, and any one of you who is able to marry him, then you should do so. Sayyidah Khadija said, all of my friends said to the man, be quiet, how dare you speak to us about marriage? Are you not ashamed? Move away from here. She said, except I didn't speak. And soon as he said that, it struck my heart that one day will come and I will marry that final Prophet. Allah inspired her heart and brought this news to her heart that one day will come and she will marry that final and last Prophet. And that's exactly what happened. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go out in the cave of Hira for months, for days on end, for nights on end, and he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Sayyidah Khadija would organize for him his provision, and she would look after his house and let him go into the bewilderment and to sit all alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worshipping through pondering upon the heavens and the earth. And one day, Sayyidah Khadija thought, she had a longing towards him. She thought, it's been so many days I haven't seen him. So she walked all the way to Hira and she looked into the cave, and she climbed up the mountain and she looked into the cave, and she saw that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting all alone in seclusion, and it seemed like he was in deep intimacy with his creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she didn't disturb him, and she just came back and waited until he came back to the house and she met with him. Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha was that honorable woman whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave from her womb all of his children. All of his children were from Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha, except for Ibrahim, who was from Mari al-Qibtiyah later on in Madinatul Munawwara. But all of his children that survived, i.e. his daughters who grew up, and the most beloved of his children, Sayyidah Fatima al-Zahra radiallahu anha, was from Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha. So this indicates how close Khadija radiallahu anha was to the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If his most beloved child is from that woman, then how great was that woman in his eyes sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sayyidah Khadija was not only beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she was beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For one day, Jibreel alayhi salam came to the Prophet and said, shortly Khadija will come to you and she will have a bowl of soup or a bowl of food. And when she comes, extend unto her salam from Allah and from me. And Khadija arrived and the Prophet said to her, Jibreel alayhi salam came and informed me that Allah gives you salam, and Jibreel extends salam to you. So Sayyidah Khadija said, Allahumma anta as-salam, wa minka as-salam, wa alayhi as-salam. Oh Allah, you are the salam, and from you is salam, and upon Jibreel there be salam also. Upon Jibreel there also be salam. And Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu anha created a house of comfort, and created a house of ease, and created a house of tranquility and peace for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon the earth. This is why in return, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say to her, Allah has created for you a house in paradise, la sakhaba fihi wa la nasab. There is no tiredom in it And nor are there any voices raised, and nor is there any argumentation in that house. And Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, she lived through the most difficult times of life with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's the test of true love. That's the test of true love. Because the honeymoon doesn't last for a lifetime, does it? The honeymoon doesn't last for a lifetime. But the people of our time, they expect it to last forever. Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha lived the most difficult of times with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you know she lived with him at a time when he was banished out of Mecca with his companions and she was still in Makkah al-Mukarrama? The Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stayed in the valley of Abu Talib for 3 years. They were exiled. They were not allowed to do any business transactions with the people of Makkah. The people of Makkah were not allowed to buy and sell from them. They were not allowed to get married from the people of Makkah. They were, all interaction was cut off between the Meccans and the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The only route that they had into Makkah was Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha. And do you know the Sahaba at that time, they were so empty of food that the Sahaba said that our children used to cry because we had no food to feed them. And we used to eat leaves and we used to eat tree branches to have some food in our stomachs. Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha, she put her neck on the line and she would secretly bring in food for the Prophet and the Sahaba for 3 years. What a woman of courage. What a woman of bravery. What a woman of strength that her husband is in such exile. And look at how she was helping him. And look at how she was looking after him. And look at how she wasn't complaining, I don't have this in life and I don't have that in life. But rather she was standing beside him and going through the difficulty of life alongside him to indicate her love and her deep affiliation and loyalty with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of our teachers, the great Allama of Damascus, Shaykh Adib Kallas radiallahu anhu, he lived a very difficult life. He lived a very poor and a very difficult life. Our teachers told us that he used to praise his wife in lessons. Very often he used to praise his wife, that she's a very pious woman, a very patient woman, and she looked after me very well. He was so empty of material in his house that he lived in one room. And when students used to come and study from him in that room, his wife used to sit under the staircase. His wife used to sit under the staircase. And they never used to have meat in the house to eat. If anybody ever came and gifted them meat, do you know his wife wouldn't cook that meat? She would store it away in the freezer and she would cook it on the day when her family would come to visit them. Why? So that her family doesn't realize that she is living through such difficult times with her husband. So that her family doesn't realize that they are going through such poverty and such difficulty. This is loyalty and this is true love. What we have in the world now is just disposable. Use and abuse. Use and dump. That's it. But this is true loyalty and love. And our teacher Shaykh Adib said, I heard this from his own grandson who is in my class. He said that my grandmother has been ill for the past 40 years. My grandmother has been ill for the past 40 years. And during those 40 years, she has been constantly saying to my grandfather, please marry again, please marry again. But he said, I will never marry again for the loyalty and love that you showed me. And you stood beside me in my days of difficulty. I will never give you up and marry anybody else. He was patient for 40 years through the illness of his wife. This is true loyalty and true love that the people of Islam picked up from the marriages of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they applied them into their marriages. This is why they lived successful lives. But now, in the lands of Islam and wherever we are, the divorce rate is much higher than the marriage rate. Why? Because we are not adhering to the marriages of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We want everything to be lovey-dovey and honeymoon and everything is cool, but we don't realize. But when the bills kick in, when you have to start to pay and you have to start to look after, that's when the tough time of life comes in, people give up. And now we have a trend. We have a trend in the United Kingdom. People get married and they go on a honeymoon. They go on the same plane, but when they return, they come on different planes. Seriously, this is becoming a widespread trend. When they go on honeymoon, they go on the same plane. When they return, they come on different planes, different airports, and different times. And that's it, it's finished. Why? Because it's not based upon true love and true loyalty. People think true love is, oh, you found somebody on Facebook? Oh, they look very nice. They look very handsome. You don't know about their qualities. You don't know about their family. You don't know how they grew up. You don't know what they've been up to in life. You want to marry them? Oh, I've fallen in love. No, you haven't. You've given your heart cheap. That's what's happened. You've given up the most precious thing that Allah has given you just to somebody you found on Facebook, just to somebody who tweeted you, just to somebody who sent you a WhatsApp message with an icon picture of their face, which was covered with foundation. Really, this is the reality of the time that we live in. None of this is love. All of this is fake. All of this is fake. True love only comes out at times of difficulty. You test the waters when times are troubling. You don't test the waters when everything is fine and everybody is in happiness and in comfort. When you go through a troubling time, you want to find a friend who's going to come and give you a hand. But you know what happens in troubling times? People say, oh yes, I was busy, I didn't see my phone. My WhatsApp wasn't activated, my Facebook was down. They give up on you. One of my teachers, he said, when I was in Damascus, his wife had a serious accident. His wife had a serious accident at home and she burnt her face very severely because she fell on oil that was in a pot that was boiling and she burnt her face very severely. And she was one of the righteous awliya Allah and from the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My teacher said, when I was going through this difficult time, I had no money left. People came and gave me gifts, boxes of chocolate and things like that. He said, I had to sell valuables in my house for the treatment of my wife. He said, only one man came to me and said, if you need any help, I have 5,000 liras spare, I can spare you them. I said to him, Jazakallahu khaira. Why? Because you know when the times of difficulty come, people just say, you carry on in life. But true lovers are those وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. They will give up that which they are in need of, that which they have, they will give it up and give others priority over themselves. This is why Sayyidah Khadijah, her amazement is like no other woman upon this earth. Her greatness is not like any other woman. We can't even imagine to comprehend how great this woman was when the Prophet was in such difficult times that he would walk in the streets of Makkah and his Sahaba would be tortured in front of his eyes. It was Khadijah who would give him comfort. It was Khadijah who would give him peace and give him tranquility at home and make him feel that Allah will help. Allah will send victory and Allah will send success. The Meccan life wasn't easy. Do you know the Prophet would walk past the family of Sayyidina Ammar and they would be tortured. What would he say? صَبْرًا يَا آلَ يَاسِرٍ فَإِنَّ مَوْعِدَكُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Patience, O family of Yasir, for your destination is paradise. He couldn't do anything for them. And the first martyr of Islam, the first person who gave their life up for Islam was Sayyida Sumayya radiallahu anha. It was a woman. The Prophet would see this in Makkah. Who was it that was giving him comfort? His mother had passed away. His father had died before he was born. His grandfather had passed away. There was nobody except Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha who was giving him love, giving him affection, pouring onto him everything, every loyalty that she had in her heart towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We can't even imagine the greatness of this great woman. Just listen to what the Quran says. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا نِسَاءَ النَّبِيِّ لَسْتُنَّكَ أَحَدٍ مِّنَ النِّسَاءِ. O wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are not like any other women. If that's the case of all of the wives, then at the top of the list is Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, who not only was his wife, but she was the mother of his children. Not only the mother of his children, she was the mother of Sayyidah Fatima and the grandmother of Sayyidun al-Hasan wal-Husayn radiallahu anhum ajma'een. The greatness of this great woman is beyond comprehension, is beyond understanding, is beyond human mind as to how much loyalty and how much love she gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And true loyalty and true love that she would give up everything of hers for her beloved husband sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would come home after a hard day of being in the busy mists of Makkah, she would place her hand on the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and give him comfort. And she would comfort him. She would nurture his children at home in such a way, such a beautiful way, that when he would come home and see his children, they would be the coolness of his eyes. She would look after his house. She was the security and comfort of the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why shouldn't he have repaid her with so much love? And you know, towards the end of Sayyidah Khadijah's life, she was worried. He lived 24 years with Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha. How long? 24 years with this single wife. And how dare the people of the world speak against our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May their tongues be cut out. May their tongues be cut out. How dare they extend their tongues in ill words towards our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He lived with Sayyidah Khadijah for 24 years without marrying any other woman. And she was years and years and years older than him. And she was a widow not once but twice. And she had children before him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam still married her and showed her so much love and showed her so much loyalty that when Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha said, مَا غِرْتُ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّن نِسَاءِ النَّبِيِّ sallallahu alaihi wasallam كَمَا غِرْتُ عَلَىٰ خَدِيجَةٍ. She said, I was never jealous of any of the wives of the Prophet the way I was jealous of Khadijah. Why? He wouldn't enter into his house or exit from his house except that he would make mention of Khadijah. Khadijah was the wird of his tongue. Day and night he would speak about Khadijah. And Sayyidah Aisha said, Messenger of Allah, she was an old woman. Allah has given you a young virgin woman. And the Prophet's face would go red. And he would say, I swear by Allah, Allah has never given me better than Khadijah. This was our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who they speak about, we don't know. And we don't want to know. How rude of them. How ill of them. May their tongues be taken out. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he wanted to gift the Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, he didn't walk in the markets of Makkah and look for the precious things of Makkah to gift her. He raised his blessed hands towards the sky and he took a bunch of grapes from the gardens of paradise and he presented them to Khadijah radiallahu anha. She ate from the foods of paradise while she was walking the streets of Makkah. Why? Because of the loyalty and love that she gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was no other woman upon this earth like Khadijah radiallahu anha. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her towards the end of her life, when she was upon her deathbed, the Prophet said to her, I know this is a difficult time, but sometimes through difficulties Allah brings ease. And through this difficulty of yours, the ease that Allah will bring to you, that I will be your husband in the gardens of paradise. And Sayyidah Khadijah said, is that the case? Really, will you be my husband in Jannah? And the Prophet said, indeed, I will be your husband in Jannah. And Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, she was so happy and joyful that she said, بِالرَّفَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ. May it be with happiness and many children. May it be with happiness and many children. And Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, after 24 years of marriage with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through living through a difficult time of the Meccan life, she didn't migrate to Medina. Medina was the time when they have comfort, when ease came to the Muslims, when it wasn't the difficulties of Makkah, but it was only Khadijah who lived through the difficulties of Makkah. Why? Because of the bravery of this woman, the courage of this woman, the strength of this woman, the determination of this woman, the iman and faith of this woman, the love of and loyalty of this woman was such that no other woman would have been able to bear the difficulties of Makkah except Khadijah. All the rest were in Medina, except for Sayyidah Khadijah. She was the one who was able to bear the difficulties and the hardships of Makkah. This is why he stayed for 24 years with Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha until she passed away. And then he buried her with his own blessed hands in Makkatul Mukarramah. And even till this day, her blessed grave is a place of joy and a place of illumination and a place of fragrance for the believing people who visit it. I had one friend, he said to me, he said, every time I go to the grave of Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, from within her grave, a fragrance comes out that I smell every time I go to her grave. And he said, I took my children and they experienced that same fragrance from the blessed grave of Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha. And our teacher, the great Imam and Muhaddis of the Haramain al-Sharifain, Sayyid Muhammad bin Alawi rahmatullahi alayhi, he had a very deep connection and affiliation onto his mother, Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha. One of our teachers, the son of Shaykh Adib Kallas, Shaykh Bilal Kallas, he went to visit Sayyid Muhammad rahmatullah alayhi in his house in Makkah. And the Sayyid said to him, are you married? He said, not yet. So he said to one of the students, he said, go and bring me the hand of Khadijah radiallahu anha. He used to have an envelope which he used to call the hand of Khadijah. He used to have an envelope which he used to call the hand of Khadijah. In there he used to place money for those who wanted to get married, but they didn't have enough, and he used to pass that over to them and say, take this money from Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha and Allah will make marriage easy for you. Allah will make marriage easy for you. So this Sayyid had a great relationship and a deep affiliation onto his mother, Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha. And we all should have a deep connection to our mother, Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said to one companion who asked him, he said, Messenger of Allah, how can I be good to my parents once they leave this world? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you be good to your parents by praying their janazah, by making dua for them, and by connecting onto their friends. By connecting onto their friends. Sayyidah Khadijah was our mother. We pray for her. And we connect onto her children. And we connect onto her household. We show love and loyalty towards her children in hope that that will bring comfort to her heart. And Allah will turn her sight towards us. And then she will become our interceder before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that he will embrace us in this world, in our graves, and on the day of standing. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes this gathering a gathering that is accepted in his court and the court of his beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in the court of our mother Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he rewards Sidi bin Alawi for arranging this gathering so that we can come together and be reminded of our mother and speak about our mother and sit together and inhale the fragrance of the fragrance of our blessed mother radiyallahu anha that is spread in the hearts of the believing people wherever they be across the earth. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he not part us from her until we enter into the gardens of paradise besides her and with her great husband, the liege lord of all of the prophets and messengers sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa barak wa sallam. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Nullified.
Yes. If family we just visit them, visit Rasulullah, his chambers, make noise kind of thing, does it apply to that?
Yeah. Good question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Hujurat that those who raise their voices above the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah said, don't raise your voices above his voice. لا ترفعوا أصواتكم فوق صوت النبي ولا تجهروا له بالقول كجهر بعضكم لبعض أَنْ تَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Allah said, don't raise your voices above His voice, and don't call out to Him the way you call out to each other. Why? Because if you do so, then your deeds will become null, وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ, whilst you might not even realize what has happened. The question is this only for the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? When this verse was revealed, after this verse was revealed, Sayyidina Umar used to whisper to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to whisper. And there was one companion, he stopped coming to the masjid. He sat at home, he didn't come to the masjid. The Prophet asked, where's this man gone? They said, we don't know. He said, go and find him. One companion went to his house, and there he was, crying and crying. He said, what's wrong with you? He said, I'm finished. He said, why? He said, I've got such a loud voice, and I speak louder than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My actions are finished. So the man went back and told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he's saying that his actions are null and he's become a munafiq and he raises his voice above yours. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam summoned him and called him and he said, you can do whatever you want, you are not included in this verse. Because his voice was naturally loud. His voice was naturally loud. Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, he would never allow anybody to raise their voice in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he would say, this verse applies after his lifetime as it applied in his lifetime. This is why it is very important that when we go to Madinatul Munawwara, that we learn the correct adab of going to Medina. And that is, the greatest adab of going to Medina is to go with a broken heart and with emptiness and with silence. With silence. Our teacher, the great Imam, Shaykh Badruddin al-Hassani radiallahu anhu, one of his students, Shaykh Mahmud al-Rankusi, rahmatullah alayhi, said, we went to Madinatul Munawwara with this great Imam of Hadith, and we got to the door of Salam, we've got to Babu Salam, and we said to the Shaykh, let's enter. He said, who am I to enter? He said, who am I to enter before the majesty of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? He stood at Babu Salam, and he said, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulallah. He heard the reply come from the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, saying to him, peace be upon you, my child. And then he would return. He would not enter before the chambers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam out of adab. There was one man we saw in Madinatul Munawwara, and he was sitting right at the back of the masjid. And he is a resident of Madinatul Munawwara. He said, for the past 25 years, I haven't moved past here. For the past 25 years, I have not moved past here. This is where I sit. I don't go ahead. Why? Because these people knew the adab of being in the presence and in the masjid and around the chambers of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have to be very careful when we are in his presence. And the scholars have said this also applies to gatherings in which hadith is recited, that nobody else other than the reciter of hadith raises their voice above the voice of the reciter. Why? Because these are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being recited.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa salaam wa
rahmatullah. We connect with Rasulullah through salawat, but how do we connect with Sayyidatul Khadijah?
We connect to Sayyidatuna Khadija radiallahu anha also through salawat, because in some of the salawat that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, he also included his zawjat wa azwajihi. Is that clear? So that's one of the ways of connecting onto her. Another way of connecting onto her is, just imagine this. If somebody loses their mother, how is it that a child, a son or a daughter, after losing that mother, will raise their hands towards Allah and make dua for that mother and show affection and love and an emotion towards that mother? Like this and much more should be the way we make dua for Sayyidah Khadijah and ask for her intercession in this world and in the next. And by showing love towards her children. When I was in Damascus, there was a very close Sayyid friend of mine. And one day he told me, he said he had a dream. And in that dream he saw that there were lots of people traveling towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was a big road and people were traveling towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, and there was two people from amongst those people who didn't travel on the long road. They took a shortcut and they reached the Prophet. He said to me, do you know why they took a shortcut? Because they served the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They served the children of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so they would take a shortcut and reach the Prophet before everybody else on this path. Allahumma salli wa sallam.
Any more questions?
Salam.
Can you explain further what Adam was visiting Sayyidina Khadijah?
When the general etiquette of visiting the Sahaba or the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the righteous is that when we attend there, you know what the scholars used to do? Shaykh Yusuf al-Nabhani mentions this also. He says, when you go to Madinatul Munawwara, be as generous as you can in Medina before you visit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because if you are generous to the people of his city, when you go to him, he will be generous to you. And the scholars, what they used to do is, when they used to visit scholars or the graves of the righteous, they used to take the young children of the area and put them in front of them and say, and speak to those people in the graves and say, we intercede, we use these children of your area, of your locality, to intercede to you and to give you salam. Why? Because children are sincere and they are clean-hearted and they are pure and they are loved even by those who are in their graves. Do you know why they are loved by them? Because by these children, Allah relieves the punishment of the people of the grave. Allah relieves the people in their graves of punishment. So when we visit, for example, Sayyidah Khadijah radiallahu anha, we should be very generous in Mecca to the Meccan people because they were her people. And when we go there, we should give salam to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first and foremost. Why? Because upon every grave and upon every believing person, whether dead or alive, it is the nur and light of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is shining within them and that is igniting and illuminating iman in their hearts. So salam should be given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first, and then with brokenness a person should communicate and give salam to a person's own mother. You should feel, this is my mother. And the affection that you would have for a mother who passes away and you stand beside her grave, only those who have lost their mothers would know how that feels.
Salatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. MashaAllah, alhamdulillah. Peace and blessings to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all to his family members, especially to our mother Khadijah radiyallahu anha. Probably many of you have been together with Shaykh Mohammed Aslam for the past few days to hear about the seerah and shama'il of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also about his family members, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to place us together with them, insha'Allah, ameen ya rabbal alameen. And indeed, this is one of the best way you can get close and you can increase love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tamam. If you do not know that person, then how do you want to love that person? And it is very important for us to get to know Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because if it's not because of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we would not be created. Just as how has been mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a narration in a hadith, which Nabi Adam alayhi salam experienced with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tamam. When Adam alayhi salam was taken out from Jannah, and it is not because he intentionally sins Allah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for him to be sent to the earth. Tamam. To complete the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. As how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that Nabi Adam alayhi salam, he has done mistakes, وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. Yani he didn't do it intentionally, Nabi Adam alayhi salam. And there's one story, tamam, about the discussion between Nabi Adam and Nabi Musa alayhi salam. Tamam, in the hadith mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when Nabi Musa met Nabi Adam, he said, oh Adam, my father Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you using his hands, not literally, means with his strength and will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you with his hands, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed you in Jannah, and you are the father of all mankind, you are the first prophet out of all prophets. And then you did something which has taken all of us out of Jannah. Where did you so? Then Nabi Adam alayhi salam. Look at, these are the way prophets converse to each other. Out of their high level of wisdom and respect. First they will praise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you. You are the father of all mankind. Oh mashallah, he has praised you. You are the first person to be in Jannah. And everything after that, why did you take us out from Jannah? And then Nabi Musa told Nabi Adam. And then Nabi Adam alayhi salam. Ya Musa kalimullah. Oh Musa. The person who converses with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tamam. Tamam. And you are one of the chosen prophets and amongst the ulul azm. Taib. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you prophecy and Torah. One of the chosen books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed to give you the Torah? Is it before he has created me or after he has created me? And then Nabi Musa alayhi salam, before he has created you, before you were created, then are you blaming me for the mistake that I have done, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed upon me even before I was created? So we have to understand the prophets alayhi salatu wasalam before we are able to love them. We have to understand the level of the Ahl Bayt in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam before we are able to love them. And it is enough that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Quran, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. O Muhammad, tell them, لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا, that I do not ask any reward or benefit from you, إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, except that you love my household, يعني sallallahu alayhi wasallam. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Verily indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove from you the filth. What filth? What is the greatest filth? Shirk billah, al-kufr billah. And know that a person, if he comes from the Ahl Bayt in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if his nasab is right and his parents got married correctly, then he will not die as a kafir or mushrik. This is the best gift Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give a person, which all of us yani, who are not amongst the Ahl Bayt, we die crying, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to just let us die as a Muslim. But this has been guaranteed for the Ahlul Bayt in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How can we not love such people? How can we not respect them? You do not respect them except for a wrong understanding that you have in your heart or in your head. Or the ignorance, continuous ignorance that you have and you purposely don't want to respect. Ego, that's all. Nothing else. Therefore, you have heard many stories by Shaykh Mohammed Aslam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve him, give him more ilm insha'Allah, and let him return to us and teach us more and more knowledge of Islam, that we can benefit and increase our iman and the love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Preserve him, give him long life, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him and all of us amongst the salihin. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. So now, one thing left. You have heard a lot from the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have heard a lot from the akhlaq of Khadijah Al Kubra radiyallahu anha. And we can see a lot from the life of Rasulullah and his family members and his sahaba, regardless whether they are men or women, they don't complain. No complaints. We in our life, everywhere we go, there's just something not right. We live in Malaysia, the government is not good. You go to European countries, you say it's expensive. You go to Singapore, you say the country is too strict. You go to some other place of the world, you go to Yemen, you say this is a third world country, needs to be done, and it... Yani, what's wrong with you? لِكُلِّ مَقَامٍ مَقَالٍ. For every single level, there are words being uttered. Whatever you say, it shows your level. Whatever words you use, it shows your personality. So if you like to complain, then know that you have some sickness in yourself. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever He has given you. Look at how was the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. Their whole life was a journey of jihad and spreading of Islam. They have never been some like long period of time. They would just stay at home, relax, just like us, mashallah, enjoy some good food, speak to their family members and sit down, mashallah. Tamam. There's nothing to complain. Their life is all the time on the... Yeah, I need to travel from one country to another country, from one country to another country, just to spread the message of Islam. And how much importance they have given to spread the message of Islam. And look at ourselves, how much importance we have given to ourselves before the spreading message of Islam, which has never been done by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, neither his inheritors. They sacrificed their food, their meal, just to be able to go a little bit extra mile to spread Islam. They sacrificed their family members at home, just to go a little bit more extra mile to sacrifice for the sake of Islam. They do everything, wealth, everything they do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And take this advice. وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Instruction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially for the ladies of the believers. Tamam. Of the believers. Also generally for the men. وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ. And mention about whatever which is being recited in your houses. Min ayatillah, from the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal hikmah, and from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When such thing has happened, inna Allah ka'ana latifan khabira. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most gentleness, and He knows everything. Jalla jalaluhu wa ta'ala fi'ula. You want to instill gentleness in your family, in your house, in your household, then mention from the verses of Al-Quran and mention from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you will have gentleness. Then you will get the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tamam. فَبَشِّرْ عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَ. You have heard a lot of things throughout these gatherings and these advices, and you have been attending majlis, one majlis to another majlis, one majlis to another majlis. Repent to Allah. It's enough for whatever we have done in the past. It's time for us to strive to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put our desire aside. And take those advices which is given to you again and again by scholars. Radiallahu anhum ajma'in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve all of them. فَبَشِّرْ عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ. And give glad tidings to those people. الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ. When they hear advices, فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَهُ. They follow the best advices. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَاهُمُ اللَّهُ. Those are the people who I guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And those are the people who have intellect. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He bless our gathering, make our gathering amongst those gathering who is being gazed upon by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Gatherings where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save the ummah, save the difficulties that the ummah is going through with the barakah of this gathering. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove all the difficulties that we have in ourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove all the difficulties which the ummah is facing, especially our brothers in Syria and anywhere else in the world who are facing difficulties with finding basic necessities in their life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the most difficult thing that Muslims are facing, which is disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Know that there is nothing which is more difficult and more dangerous than disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wa al-afu minkum.
اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وحيث تشرفت الأسماع بذكر أخبارها وبيان فضائلها ونشر آثارها حسن منا أن نختم ذلك بالدعاء متوجهين إلى الله رب العالمين قاصدين مخلصين قائلين الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم أنت أحق من ذكر وأحق من عبد وأرأف من ملك وأجود من سئل وأوسع من أعطى أنت الملك لا شريك لك والفرد لا ند لك كل شيء هالك إلا وجهك لا تطاع إلا بإذنك ولن تعصى إلا بعلمك تطاع فتشكر وتعصى فتشكر وتعصى فتغفر أقرب شهيد وأدنى حفيظ حلت دون النفوس وأخذت بالنواصي وكتبت الآثار ونسخت الآجال القلوب لك مفضية والسر عندك علانية الحلال ما أحللت والحرام ما حرمت والدين ما شرعت والأمر ما قضيت والخلق خلقك والعبد عبدك وأنت الله الغفور الرحيم نسألك بنور وجهك الكريم الذي أشرقت له السماوات والأرض وبكل حق هو لك وبحق السائلين عليك أن تقيلنا وتجيرنا من النار بقدرتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم نحمدك على ما هديت ونشكرك على جزيل ما أسديت ونستعينك على رعاية ما أسبغت من النعم ونستهديك الشكر على ما كفيت من النقم ونعوذ بك من عشرات اللسان وغفلات الجنان ومن غدرات الزمان ونسألك اللطف فيما قضيت وقدرت والمعونة على ما أمضيت ونستغفرك من قول يعقبه الندم أو فعل تزل به القدم فأنت الثقة لمن توكل عليك والعصمة لمن فوض أمره إليك وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد ربنا عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير اللهم افتح مسامع قلوبنا لذكرك وارزقنا طاعتك وطاعة نبيك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعملا بكتابك واتباعا لسنة نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم اجعلنا نخشاك وكأننا نراك أبدا حتى نلقاك وأسعدنا بتقواك ولا تشقنا بمعصيتك اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى وحسن الظن وحسن الخلق اللهم أغننا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وبفضلك عمن سواك اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من جهد البلاء ودرك الشقاء وسوء القضاء وشماتة الأعداء وعضال الداء وخيبة الرجاء اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وألسنتنا من الكذب وأعيننا من الخيانة إنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور اللهم جمل أمورنا ما أحييتنا وعافنا ما أبقيتنا بارك لنا فيما خولتنا واحفظ علينا ما أوليتنا وارحمنا إذا توفيتنا وسامحنا إذا حاسبتنا ولا تسلبنا الإيمان وقد هديتنا اللهم إنا نسألك رحمة من عندك تهدي بها قلوبنا وتجمع بها شملنا وتلم بها شعثنا وترد بها الفتن عنا وتصلح بها حالنا وتحفظ بها غائبنا وترفع بها شاهدنا وتبيض بها وجوهنا وتزكي بها أعمالنا وتلهمنا بها رشدنا وتعصمنا من كل سوء اللهم أعطنا إيمانا صادقا ويقينا ليس بعده كفر ورحمة ننال بها شرف كرامتك اللهم إنا نسألك الفوز عند القضاء ونزول الشهداء ومرافقة الأنبياء والنصر على الأعداء اللهم خذ بأيدينا في المضائق واكشف لنا وجوه الحقائق ووفقنا لما تحب وترضى واعصمنا من الزلل ولا تسلبنا ستر إحسانك وقنا مصارع السوء واكفنا كيد الخائنين وشماتة الأعداء واللطف بنا والطف بنا في سائر تصرفنا واكفنا من جميع جهاتنا يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أعطنا من الدنيا ما تقينا بها به فتنها وتغنيها بها عن أهلنا ويكون بلاغا لنا إلى ما هو خير منها فإنه لا حول ولا قوة إلا بك اللهم إنا نسألك نعمة تامة ورحمة شاملة وعافية دائمة وعيشة رغيدة وعمرا سعيدا وإحسانا تاما وإنعاما عاما وعملا صالحا وعلما نافعا ورزقا واسعا اللهم كن لنا ولا تكن علينا واختم بالسعادة آجالنا وحقق بالزيادة أعمالنا واقرن بالعافية غدونا وآصالنا واجعل إلى رحمتك مسيرنا وآمالنا واصبب سجال عفوك على ذنوبنا ومن علينا بإصلاح أعمالنا واستر عيوبنا واجعل التقوى زادنا وفي دينك اجتهادنا وعليك توكلنا واعتمادنا اللهم ثبتنا على نهج الاستقامة وأعذنا من موجبات الندامة يوم القيامة وخفف عنا ثقل الأوزار وارزقنا عيشة الأبرار واكفنا واصرف عنا شر الأشرار وأعتق رقابنا ورقاب آبائنا وأمهاتنا من النار يا عزيز يا غفار يا كريم يا ستار يا حليم يا جبار برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم وكما مننت على السيدة خديجة بتمام التصديق والإيمان بنبيك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن علينا بذلك يا قديم الإحسان وكما تفضلت علينا بتعظيم حرمته وحفظ عهده وذمته ونصر حزبه ودعوته ومتابعة سبيله وسنته وتأييد كلمته وحجته وتفضل علينا بذلك واكتب لنا من ذلك الحظ الأوفر والنصيب الأكبر ووفقنا للاستمساك بسنته ولزوم ملته حتى نموت عليها واحشرنا في زمرته وتحت لوائه وجعلنا من رفقائه وأوردنا حوضه واسقنا بكأسه وانفعنا بمحبته وتب علينا واحفظنا من جميع البلاء والبلوى وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين الفاتحة